Welcome to Studio 12. Today we talk about humanitarian crisis in Sudan's Darfur, its depth, its history, and its influence on our daily lives. We host two special guests. The first one is Tomo Krishner, human rights activist, world traveler, and film co-producer of the movie Darfur, War for Water. And the second guest is Suleiman Jamus, its humanitarian coordinator of Sudan Liberation Army Unity Group. Welcome both.
Thank you.
To start with, what is the history of the Sudan Darfur crisis? What are the main points?
I think I should start with at least giving thanks and condolences to the Slovenian community that they lost their late president Drnošek. And a special thanks for all the Slovenians, at least when they participated in that campaign of releasing me, which was raised by my friend Tomo Krishna, when I was a prisoner in Kaduguli for 448 days because of that signature of that agreement made in Abuja. Last 5th of May 2006, and I refused it. Then I was subjected to imprisonment in Kaduguli, and the whole international community participated in a campaign to get me out of there. And the Slovenians' role, Slovenian individuals' role was very big and very vital and very recognizable and very appreciated, because the signature all over the world was about 1,253 individuals, among them over 400 were Slovenians. Thank you for that, and thank you for the attempt made by the late president in this regard, and then the attempt of the late president of solving the whole crisis. He was very determined, but I think this did not give him the chance to proceed or to carry on with that initiative, and we thank that also. Then on, to speak about the conflict and the start of the conflict, it was a long story of marginalization, and we got our independence in 1956. Since then, those who inherited the administration of the country from the colonizing administration, they marginalized everyone except their inner circle, a very small one, consists of three families, three tribes. They try to have the power on Sudan forever. And when everyone demands his rights, his basic human rights, the response was just a gun and to be killed. Like what happened to our southerners, our friends in the southern part of Sudan, and then the Darfurians, and then the Easterns. And even the southerners, when they went there to make some kind of water dam, people refused, and they were killed also in broad daylight. And the Darfurians were marginalized, and they started some kind of protest. The independence one was in 1956. Then in 1960, they started protesting, and then 1961, 1965, and 1975 also, they attempted a coup, and they failed, and others tried to mobilize war from the south, depending on the relations between the west and the south, but also they were defeated in 1991. Then in 1999, we tried, and all this time we were trying to negotiate politically our rights and to have them from the center, from those mobilizers of the power in the center. We tried the best possible politically, but we were denied, and our people in Darfur, they started war in 2002. Since then, the fight is going on, affecting everything in Darfur, destroying everything in Darfur, and the crisis is very clear, I think, for those who have the chance to travel to see the site on the ground. And it is not only the start of 2002, this is the conflict turned to a violence, but the conflict started since the day we are independent and in some kind of marginalization. And that is what is implemented by the center. And to solve the problem, they thought of some kind of changing the demography of Darfur. Darfur is inhabited by the majority of African rooted tribes, and then they feel that if the demography is changed, at least by Arabs immigrated from outside the country, from Chad, from Cameroon, from Mali, to settle in Darfur, they may change the demography by driving the inhabitants, the old ones, to cross the border outside the country towards Chad, or to be driven to internally displaced camps around the towns. So what is seen in the world, that as if you can say there is some kind of war, it's because of the policy, how the Sudan is ruled by one ethnic group consisting of two or three families, and they inherited the administration of Sudan from the colonizer, and they insist that it should not go to any other one, and they try to sideline anyone. Because of that, the conflict of Sudan to the south, to the east, to the north, and to the west. These are the marginalized people. Now they are demanding their rights, and the center is refusing. So the fight is because of this only.
Tomo, you traveled through Darfur quite some time. How would you describe, through our Western eyes, the situation in Darfur?
The whole Darfur is affected by the war. At least 4 to 5 million people are in the camps. 300,000 to 500,000 people are dead. Most of the villages are destroyed. You can see that they have been burned or bombed. The land is empty. You can't go there, actually. You have to go illegally. All the news which we have here in the West are, we got them illegally. Once you left Chad and to travel through Darfur, you see an empty land, you see desertification, you see that Sahara is advancing from north, you see sand and empty villages, no people. So the whole feeling is like the genocide is going on at least the last seven, at least from 2003, when we first time heard for these conflicts. We didn't know before about this. So you come back to Europe very depressed, and anybody who saw Darfur feel frustrated. And I didn't meet one foreign visitor who do not need to do something to change situation. I didn't meet one who would now be capable to go for holidays and forget all about. We all feel very, very angry that the world community is not doing enough, that these women and children are still in the camps. Most of them, they are women and children, isn't so? And that we men, we watch football and we drink beer and we just think where to go for holidays, maybe in Jamaica, maybe to Florida. But in the same time, the people are screaming and crying for help just here over the same sea, over the other side of Mediterranean and across the Sahara.
What's your opinion that the international media or the Europe media doesn't cover the topics, doesn't give informations, like we would like to be blank or don't want to see? What's the story behind that?
It's, I think, a combination of so many things. The first thing, I should blame ourselves. As rebels, we did not approach the media so often, and we did not speak about the conflict and the roots of the conflict so much to the international community. And the international community is so much affected by the media of the governor of Sudan, with the idea of the governor of Sudan. And I don't blame them, because it's difficult to travel to our area, definitely. And when we found the chance, we may not speak about the conflict from the roots, most of us. So I think it's a combination of so many faults. Among them, that we can say for ourselves, we need to speak much about ourselves, about the conflict to the media. And then the same thing, the media should at least travel to us, as my friend Tomo did. And he's an individual. I know so many others came, but I think the world is very wide, and the the sources of news and information are very limited in some areas, like efforts made in Slovenia. It cannot be seen in the other parts of the world. If even the planet is becoming very small by the effect of the media. But I think it's a fail from our side to use the media and to introduce ourselves to the media. And the media is not also finding the chance to come to us here. As I said, I am working in the liberated areas in Darfur with the rebels for 5 years, and it's the first time I find the chance to come to Europe. Then I think there is a need from the media to come to the area, not only to take the opinion of the governor of Sudan, they should come also to take our opinion in the field where we are in Darfur, in the jungles, and to stay a day or so with us to see, in fact, what is there. And they can also describe it better to their viewers more than we do here.
Tomo, is it possible from your point of view describe the parties in the conflict that, okay, let me say, to introduce the parties to the international media, how would you describe it?
I met all of them. In 2006, I met the representatives of four fighting groups of Darfurian rebels. The first one was Mini Minawi, Sudan Liberation Army, then Abdel Wahid, Sudan Liberation Army, then JEM, JEM meant JEM and Justice Movement, and NMRDO. NMRD, which meant National Redemption.
Redemption Movement.
Movement, yes.
Development.
Development movement, yes.
Development movement.
Mm. The strongest are the Mini Minawi SLA, because they are getting support from Libya and United States. And the JEM is more intellectual. We have them in Europe. They are not that much present in the field. They are not talking. They are not so engaged into fightings. Abdel Wahid Sudan Liberation Army, it's in Jebel Mara mostly, because they are consisted mostly from the tribe Fur. They are Abdel Wahid followers. He's in Paris, so his connection with the fighters is through satellite telephone. And I found these people the most under siege, because they can't go away from Jebel Mara. You people, Sudan Liberation Army of Mini Minawi people, can go to Chad and can even came to Europe, but not Abdel Wahid people. They have water, they have food, because they're living in the volcanic mountains. They are even lakes and waterfalls, but they are under siege of not only the government forces, not only Janjaweed, but also Mini Minawi Sudan Liberation Army, since he signed the signature. And then is the group of people which are more humanistically orientated, which are more aware that it's not important only the tribal war. It's not important only to fight for your tribe. That the whole Darfur is suffering. And they even do not believe so much in the power of guns. They know that the peace must be negotiated. You cannot force somebody to love you with gun. You must find the way through negotiation. And this is the group of Suleiman Jamous. These are people who are more educated. They was probably once part of Mini Minawi group, but they separated, and even when I came to Darfur in 2006, they was already separated, and they say we do not want to sign peace with Arabs on the American orchestrated contract, because this will give Darfur in the hands of Arabs. I sense that in the back of Mini Minawi, Signature is a secret collaboration how to share the African Darfur among the Arabs, Chinese, even Americans. This is my guesses only. But I spent with Suleiman Jamous and his people and their commanders most of the time, and I can say that they can bring peace to Darfur. Because the people, the common refugees in the camps, and the civilians in the liberated areas are respecting this man who we have now the chance to sit with us, the Suleiman Jamous. And this is why I openly supported him. And I wrote to my president, please try to meet Suleiman Jamous, come to Chad, come to the border area, met Jamous and his people, talk to them, and if you will feel the same, if you will trust him the same as I do, try to support this more humanitarian rebel side. Don't go with Mini Minawi. Mini Minawi is supported by foreigners who have interest in Darfur.
One sub question is, if I may, so we have four rebel groups, if I understand correctly. This is like one side, but they have different perspectives of how to get their rights and freedom. Then we have the government side, the Sudanese government, plus support of the Janjaweeds. And they are supported by big countries, you said.
The Janjaweed are supported by Sudan government. They are doing the dirty work for the Sudan government. This is clear, there is no doubt. We know all this.
Okay. Now, I'm interested. The influence and the support of the so-called big countries on the Sudan government side, and you also meant this SLA group. How does the big countries affect and support each side, and why?
Who will answer? I will be more critical, I think.
I think for this, I can say that there is some kind of lack of assessment from the big countries in what is the conflict itself. And they did, at least the Americans named what happened in Darfur a genocide, while Europeans are reluctant. They are only saying that it's there are some kind of war crimes occurred. And the whole media is believing that there are 200,000 people killed since the war broke. The number is much, much bigger than this. But what, let us just say that the what's said now in the media is 200,000 people killed. If 200,000 people killed, and we can't say that this is a genocide, what is the number that the world need to name it genocide? And the whole thing is based on the policy of the center, how to divide and rule, and how to change the demography of Darfur. And so because of that, the implementation of this policy on the ground was a kind of burning villages, scorching the land, looting their livelihood aspects, and this is not genocide. So I don't blame the international community, but I blame that if they are not able to assess, they should not take a decision. It's better for them to assess and to know the fact, and then based on that, your decision and your word. Americans, they depend on the numbers of the death toll, which is now completely the whole world is writing everywhere that 200,000 people were killed, and this can be named genocide in the American side. Europeans are still reluctant. So I think it's better for all to make some kind of assessment which puts the things right on the direct. After that, if someone take a side of the government of Sudan, like so many in the neighbors and neighbors of Sudan, and so many in the Arab countries taking the side of Sudan since the conflict started, and they are not ready even to see what is happening in Darfur, and we have the conflict started in 2002. The heavy fighting between the rebels and the government of Sudan, and say that 200,000 people were killed, and the whole world is crying, especially the Arab League and the Arab countries, crying that Omdurman, the base of the power in Sudan, was attacked once for one day. And from the rebels, and they are keeping an eye shut of the death toll, which is running daily basis since 6 years. Bombardment by the Antonov, gunships, helicopters, and even jet fighters like MiG of the Russian made, and Fighter Five, which is Chinese made. These are all used against the civilians, against the rebels. They are saying that they are using this against the rebels, but it is the fact that they are attacking villages, burning villages. So this kind of thing, I think, can range until you can say that this is genocide. And it's better for us all as human beings to put our efforts together to help each other to at least make some kind of stability to our planet.
So what solutions can be taken? You said that that Suleiman's perception and point of solution is more humanitarian.
Mm-hmm.
What kind of solution is this? Or idea of solution?
I believe that Suleiman Jumus believes in peace for all tribes of Darfur, not only his Zagawa Bediat tribe. I believe that you are even seeing that the peace must be made for the whole Sudan, also north, east, south, because all these areas has been marginalized by the Arab government who got the power from the colonial Britain when Britain left Sudan in 1966. And I believe that you are not for separation, for independence, but better for a real sort of democracy and maybe autonomy, as we have here in Europe, where the black has the same rights as the red, and the red has the same rights as the black, as it is written in Quran. You are a good Muslim, and I believe you follow your humanitarianism from Quran. We are not superior in our culture. Christianity is not superior to Islam, as far as I experienced. And I believe that your humanitarian principles are coming from your culture. You are not learning from us the democratic principles, neither the ideas of equality and human rights. But you should say yourself. We are introducing you today. I'm trying to help you. I know that you cannot be that critical to the West as I am, because I'm a member of this West and I can openly say what I see wrong here. So I mostly try to expose myself when we need to be critical to the Western response to the genocide in Darfur. Please tell yourself how you see your humanitarian, humanistic vision for Darfur and Sudan.
Go ahead.
Kevin, I think it's better we start with Darfur than go out. In Darfur now, we experienced this conflict since 2002, now it's 6 years. And the effect on the civilians on the ground who are not taking the side of the government or the rebels. The number of the population of Darfur is nearly 7 million. 5 million of them are war affected, either refugees out of the country or internally displaced around the towns, or trapped between the government and the rebels and the Janjaweed. They don't have the means of travel to go to the refugee camps, and they fear the road from where they are to the towns, because the road is not that much safe for them to move with their all belongings. So they were trapped and they are there, losing education, losing health care, losing even clean water to drink, and self-safety itself. So these are the subject of any solution coming if it does not meet their interests, that peace cannot be durable, cannot be sustainable on the ground. For that, I think the international community needs to address the interests of these civilians, and not the interest of the rebels or the interest of the government of Sudan. And they have come out with their own plans, which can be based on a better mandated, equipped, trained power on the ground that can at least protect these civilians from either parties and maintain a safe passage for relief aid to them. And the relief aid workers in Darfur are working in a very, very, very bad situation, very dangerous, and they are doing their best. Despite this, the government is putting obstacles, sometimes administration, sometimes sending some kind of looters and groups of banditry to harass them on the road, to steal even their belongings, their cars, their what the aid they are taking to those civilians. Then this hinders the movements and shortens the movement towards the civilians who are in need of the aid. And here I can say that the NGOs in the field, they are doing the best possible despite these obstacles, but the area of their work is not that much prepared. So if there is a power which is capable to save their convoys to where they meet the beneficiaries and they come back safely to anywhere they want, and the these people are completely dependent on either government of Sudan or the rebels, and the two are not that much trustworthy in the movements. Sometimes the rebels move much. They may be here, and tomorrow they may be in other area. So they are not stable in areas that you can say that these are the areas where the rebels can maintain the peace of the movements of the NGOs. And the government of Sudan is only in the towns. So in these gaps, in the other gaps, you can find some kind of banditry groups, some kind of warlordism shapes affecting the life of these civilians on the ground. And then say that if a child was 10 years when the conflict started, and today he is 16, he is almost a man. And what he has seen in the world is killing and bombarding and burning and like that. This man with no education, it's a part of an add to the violence for a longer time. So this may be a challenge for the international community and for those survivors, how to divert this mentality to a normal life. So I'm not warning, but this will happen, and I think the international community experienced so many other wars, and they saw the atmosphere after the conflicts, and the effect of those who survived the conflict, how they need to be treated to come back to the normal life. This is, I think, one of the fields of challenge for the international community. And for the first time, I speak about the international community, that they are doing their best, but they need assessment to know the conflict from the roots and to solve it from the roots, not to compromise the safety with jobs and posts in the government of Sudan, like what happened in Abuja last time. They made only a compromise between the government of Sudan and those who are longing to be to have some name and to have some post on the government of Sudan, and to be named and to wear better clothes and to lie on a bed. So the conflict, when the international community was misled to say that the conflict is to be solved, and the disarmament of the Janjaweed, which is the main cause of the conflict, and the name given to the Janjaweed were to be disarmed, it was put in the agreement. But in the same time, the agreement made two constitutions, like the border intelligence and the nomad police. These are the nicknames of the Janjaweed. Mm-hmm. So the address was not to the cause of the. So Janjaweed escaped disarmament by naming themselves either border intelligence or nomad police. So the conflict is there still. Because of that, we refused the last agreement happened there. And we call on the international community that that was a cheat, and that was a mismanagement because they were not aware of these two names. If even our commanders who were there should know this, but the pressure applied on Minni and the others refused to sign, but Minni signed because he was subjected to some kind of pressure, which was not was not right, because those who pressed him, they don't know what is covered in this agreement.
Can we conclude our first part of our talk with saying that there is a need in looking for peaceful solution, there is a need of convert the mentality of the local people in Darfur and also mentality of the European people, and there is also a need for a greater and better assistance of the international community to the Sudan and Darfurian people?
Is this? I think so.
I think, yes, this is what we need to say. And you have said it. If you know, you want me to repeat, I will do it.
Okay. Then thank you for the first part.